Obama's martial law executive order. Action alert. Before it snooze, H/T Anita P. I generally will not just copy and paste emails into stories but feel absolutely compelled to do so this time seeing what is at stake here. Has Barack Obama just signed away the last gasp of Americans' freedoms with a new executive order? According to this email from Conservative Action Alerts, Barack Obama has just signed another executive order. This time, he's giving new police powers to foreign police. You read that right, Obama's new Executive Order 13,524, amending Executive Order 12,425, grants the International Criminal Police Organization, Interpol, rights on American soil that place it beyond the reach of our own law enforcement agencies, such as the Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI. This lays the groundwork for Interpol to do what the President cannot legally justify doing. Interpol, on instructions from the Obama regime, will now be able to carry out actions prohibited to our own law enforcement. Barack Obama is taking the United States down the path to martial law. We must stop him now. As Andrew C. McCarthy at the National Review wrote, you just can't make up how brazen this crowd is. President Obama quietly signed an executive order that makes an international police force immune from the restraints of American law. He went on to report, Interpol is the shorthand for the International Criminal Police Organization. It was established in 1923 and operates in about 188 countries. By Executive Order 12,425, issued in 1983, President Reagan recognized Interpol as an international organization and gave it some of the privileges and immunities customarily extended to foreign diplomats. Interpol, however, is also an active law enforcement agency, so critical privileges and immunities, set forth in Section 2(c) of the International Organization's Immunities Act, were withheld. Specifically, Interpol's property and assets remain subject to search and seizure, and its archived records remain subject to public scrutiny under provisions like the Freedom of Information Act, being constrained by the Fourth Amendment, FOIA, and other limitations of the Constitution and federal law that protect the liberty and privacy of Americans is what prevents law enforcement and its controlling government authority from becoming tyrannical. On Wednesday, however, for no apparent reason, President Obama issued an executive order removing the Reagan limitations. That is, Interpol's property and assets are no longer subject to search and confiscation, and its archives are now considered inviolable. This international police force, whose the United States headquarters is in the Justice Department in Washington, will be unrestrained by the United States Constitution and American law while it operates in the United States and affects both Americans and American interests outside the United States. As Steve Shipper and Clyde Middleton's analysis of Obama's new executive order concludes, inviolable archives means Interpol records are beyond the United States Citizens Freedom of Information Act requests and from American legal or investigative discovery unless such immunity be expressly waived. Property and assets being immune from search and confiscation means precisely that, wherever they may be in the United States. This could conceivably include human assets, Americans arrested on our soil by Interpol officers. Still think Obama isn't putting all of the pieces together to implement martial law. Wake up. Congress has to act now to stop him, which means we have to force Congress to act. This is obviously only one of the pieces that Obama has moved into place on his giant chessboard. As we already reported, Obama has already taken a giant leap forward in his drive to institute martial law. According to 2009 Nobel Peace Prize nominee Jim Garrow, he claims he was told by a top military veteran that the Obama administration's litmus test for new military leaders isn't whether they are the best military commanders. It's whether or not they will obey an order to fire on the United States citizens. Garrow was nominated 3 years ago for the prestigious Nobel Peace Prize and is the founder of the Pink Pagoda Girls, an organization dedicated to rescuing baby girls from gendercide in China. Garrow has been personally involved in helping rescue more than 36,000 Chinese baby girls from death. He is a public figure, not an anonymous voice on the internet, which makes his claim all the more disturbing. I have just been informed by a former senior military leader that Obama is using a new litmus test in determining who will stay and who must join as military leaders. Get ready to explode, folks. The new litmus test of leadership in the military is if they will fire on the United States citizens or not. Those who will not are being removed, Garrow wrote on his Facebook page, later following up the post by adding the man who told him is one of America's foremost military heroes, whose goal in divulging the information was to sound the alarm. Garrow's claim is even more explosive given that the country is in the throes of a national debate about gun control, with gun rights advocates insisting that the founders put the Second Amendment in the Constitution primarily as a defense against government tyranny. It also follows reports on Sunday that General James Mattis, head of the United States Central Command, is being told to vacate his office several months earlier than planned. As reporter Paul Joseph Watson commented, concerns over the United States troops being given orders to fire on American citizens in the event of mass gun confiscation first arose in 1995 when hundreds of Marines at 29 Palms, California were given a survey as part of an academic project by Navy Lieutenant Commander Ernest Guy Cunningham, which asked the Marines if they would fire upon the United States citizens who refuse or resist confiscation of firearms banned by the United States government. The survey was subsequently leaked because many of the Marines who took it were shocked by the tone of the question. The United States military has clearly outlined innumerable civil emergency scenarios under which troops would be authorized to fire on the United States citizens. In July 2012, the process by which this could take place was made clear in a leaked the United States Army Military Police Training Manual for Civil Disturbance Operations, PDF. Dating from 2006. Similar plans were also outlined in an updated manual released in 2010 entitled FN3-39.40 Internment and Resettlement Operations. The 2006 document outlines how military assets will be used to help local and state authorities to restore and maintain law and order in the event of mass riots, civil unrest, or a declaration of martial law. On page 20 of the manual, rules regarding the use of deadly force in confronting dissidents on American soil are made disturbingly clear with the directive that a warning shot will not be fired. Given that Second Amendment advocates are now being depicted as dangerous terrorists by the federal government and local law enforcement, Garrow's claim is sure to stoke controversy given that Americans are seeing their gun rights eviscerated while the federal government itself stockpiles billions of bullets. Did you get that? You and I are now being labeled as potential terrorists because we believe in the Constitution, and Obama is signing executive orders and making executive decisions to stop patriotic Americans like us from opposing him. That's why we need to stop him first. It's now quite obvious, Obama is stepping up his drive towards martial law in America. One way he's doing it is by selling us out to the Russians. As Breitbart has reported, in an attempt to seize total control over national security and bypass Congress, a frightening new step by the Obama administration is coming into play. As noted in Friday's Wall Street Journal in an op-ed by John Bolton and John Wu, a State Department advisory group that is run by former Secretary of Defense William Perry is advising that the United States and Russia both reduce nuclear weapons without a treaty, as a treaty would require ratification by Congress. This would allow Obama and his executive branch to unilaterally cut our nuclear weaponry and ignore the treaty clause of the Constitution. This is outrageous. Obama isn't just trying to destroy America's economic system. He's out to destroy our national defense too. And combined with all of his recent executive orders granting himself more and more unlimited and unconstitutional powers, it's obvious that he's driving us towards martial law. Again and again. One after another after another. Obama keeps signing more and more executive orders and new laws to get around Congress, get around the United States Constitution, and consolidate his power. Now he's preparing to sign a newly passed bill, a bill which will actually strengthen last year's DAW bill that codified martial law. According to an article recently published in The Examiner, DAW 2012, according to rights experts, codified martial law. Award-winning journalist Chris Hedges sued the United States government over .2012, calling it corporate fascism. .2013, according to legal experts this week, strengthened the former act. By failing to veto .2012 and signing it on New Year's Eve, President Obama compromised national security and the rule of law, according to Rahawala Advocacy Council for Human Rights First. There is consequently little hope Obama will veto .2013, although appeal is being lodged for him to do so. Did you get that? Obama is about to sign into law the latest version of the National Defense Authorization Act, which will add to all of the martial law powers he's been giving himself through executive orders. Once again, it's obvious that Barack Obama is preparing to declare martial law. We must stop him now. Remember the recent headline that said it all? Obama's latest executive order freezes Americans' accounts. You read that right, now he's going directly after Americans' bank accounts. So, you think your capital is safe? You think it would take a lot to freeze your assets permanently? Silly you. All it takes is an executive order signed by the president. Here is the most recent example. It applies to all Americans, individuals and corporations. The way this legal precedent is being set is simple. It targets the latest bad guys in the ever-rotating roulette wheel of evil. Round and round it goes. Where it stops, nobody knows. Hillary and Turbo Tim Geithner will be brought into the process. They will decide, meaning faceless bureaucrats under them will decide. It's all in bureaucraties, the better to hide what the executive order is really doing. To find out who the targets are, and why the president knew he could get away with this, click the link. Of course, that executive order came right after even more outrageous news. While the whole country was distracted with a killer storm in a killer presidential election, Barack Hussein Obama was continuing with his plans to initiate martial law. Remember these almost unbelievable headlines? Just before Hurricane Sandy, Obama signed executive order merging Homeland Security with private sector to create virtual dictatorship. The news article under that headline only gets worse. While all eyes were on Hurricane Sandy in the days leading up to the storm's breach on the mainland of the Northeast, the White House was busy devising new ways to enslave Americans under the guise of protecting national security. On October 26, 2012, Barack Obama quietly signed an executive order, EO, establishing the so-called Homeland Security Partnership Council, a public-private partnership that basically merges the Department of Homeland Security, DHS, with local governments and the private sector for the implied purpose of giving the executive branch complete and limitless control over the American people. This is exactly what we've been warning you that Barack Hussein Obama has been planning for. This executive order went further than any other in conflating federal power structures with local governments and the private sector. Based on the unbelievable language contained in the EO itself, the federal government appears ready to begin rapidly expanding its command and control operations at the local level, according to a story in Natural News, by establishing a vast network of Homeland Security partnerships throughout the country, which will be tasked with reporting back to the Central Command Center and feeding intelligence information as requested by federal officials. We must tap the ingenuity outside the government through strategic partnerships with the private sector, non-governmental organizations, foundations, and community-based organizations, says the EO. It goes on to add that the merger between the federal government and the private sector is necessary to facilitate the government's desire to better address homeland security priorities, which includes things like responding to natural disasters and preventing terrorism by utilizing diverse perspectives, skills, tools, and resources. An official steering committee will be established with representatives from virtually every single federal agency, and this committee will be guided by a separate council on how to best incorporate the federal government and DHS into every nook and cranny of American society. Once established, this council will maintain control over presumably all aspects of society by overseeing a secret police force comprised of spies from schools, community groups, churches, and various other local institutions. E must institutionalize an all-of-nation effort to address evolving threats to the United States, adds the executive order, which has yet to be covered at all in the mainstream media. But why would we be surprised at that? The media still hasn't covered one of the biggest bombshells in recent weeks. One of the leading global magazines of politics, economics, and ideas, Foreign Policy Magazine, posted a bombshell on their website. General Boykin, the United States economy close to collapse, could result in martial law. You read that right. Retired Lieutenant General William Boykin, a former CIA Deputy Director of Special Activities, has said that the United States economy is just about to break and collapse. And when the dam gives way, severe food shortages and pervasive violence throughout America will result in an executive declaration of martial law. Those in the know are trying to warn us. Barack Obama is preparing to declare martial law. We must stop him now. This former CIA general's warning is huge. I'll be very honest with you, the situation in America could be such that martial law is actually warranted, and that situation in my view could occur if we had an economic collapse, says General Boykin. The dam is just about to break on our economy, and I think when it does, there's going to be a major disruption of the distribution of food, he added. And I think what you'll see particularly in the inner cities is you will see riots, civil unrest that ultimately might justify martial law. I think those people that are not in the major cities are going to be far better off, but it could actually justify martial law, Boykin continued. And I'm praying that we will not see that kind of collapse. We won't see a disruption of the distribution of food in America. That's probably the single biggest problem. How much more proof do we need? It's obvious what Obama is planning for. Not only has he ordered for his Department of Homeland Security, DHS, 1.2 billion rounds of ammo and armored checkpoint booths. Now reports are coming in that DHS has now been given fully armored APCs, the same standard used by our military, to the list of recent unsettling developments at DHS and other federal agencies, such as massive DHS IMO buys, a creepy new biometric surveillance system just being rolled out by the FBI, and drones buzzing our backyards with cameras. We can now add the appearance across the country of not just heavily armored military-grade Humvees, but GLS, armored personnel carriers, APCs, 2,500 of them to be exact. According to reports, the Department of Homeland Security already have thousands of heavily armored vehicles and DHS police-slash-rescue livery resplendent in either a dashing Gulf War 10 or menacing stealth anthracite. Once again, it's obvious that Barack Obama is preparing to declare martial law. We must stop him now. These news reports of preparations for a police state came after we had already learned that Barack Hussein Obama was planning to sign another martial law-style executive order, this time to enable him to take over America's critical infrastructure, such as the power grid and financial industries. Federal news radio reported that the Obama regime was preparing to sign off on this new executive order, since patriots like you and I have been able to stop Obama's so-called cybersecurity bill so far. The White House so far has failed to get a bill passed by both houses of Congress to improve the cybersecurity of the nation's critical infrastructure, so it wants to take an alternative approach. The administration has created a draft executive order detailing how, within its authority, it would improve the information assurance of the nation's critical infrastructure, such as the power grid and financial industries. The draft EO, which Federal News Radio viewed a draft copy of, closely follows the second version of comprehensive cyber legislation introduced by Sens. Joseph Lieberman, Icon, and Susan Collins, R. Maine, in July. Did you get that? These people failed to get their martial law bills passed in Congress, so Obama is ready to bypass our elected officials and do it himself, again. Of course, that wasn't all he did. That outrageous action by Barack Obama came not long after he announced his plans to sign yet another executive order, which will enable him to take over the internet. As WorldNet Daily reported, Obama has signaled his intention to push through his internet agenda via executive order. This, after last week's failed attempt to bring the Democrat-supported Cybersecurity Act of 2012 to a full vote in the United States Senate. The bill would have given federal regulatory agencies the ability to mandate cybersecurity recommendations on critical infrastructure, power, and utility companies. As reported in the Hill, responded to a question about whether President Obama was considering advancing his party's cyber plan through an executive order. White House Press Secretary Jay Carney didn't rule out the possibility. In the wake of congressional inaction and Republican stall tactics, unfortunately, we will continue to be hamstrung by outdated and inadequate statutory authorities that the legislation would have fixed, Carney said. And John Brennan, Obama's counterterrorism advisor, said at an event at the Council on Foreign Relations in Washington, "If the Congress is not going to act on something like this, then the president wants to make sure that we're doing everything possible. Do you get that?" Obama and his minions want full control of the internet. And Obama is once again willing to sign executive orders to take power. He just doesn't seem to stop. The threat to take over the internet came hot on the heels of another executive order, signed by Obama last July, which once again brings America a step closer to finding itself under martial law, this time by giving him dictator-type powers over all communications during any so-called crisis that he might declare. As reported by Tea Party economist, blogger, Dr. Gary North, Obama has signed an executive order outlining the nationalization of the entire communications system. It is written in bureaucratese. I have no doubt that it was not understood by Obama. It is too detailed. It sets up a powerful new bureaucracy. The language is limited to a national emergency. But an emergency on this scale is almost inconceivable. The government never discusses what could justify an executive order this comprehensive. If such a threat to the nation and the world really exists, the voters should be given a detailed description of its nature. Congress should debate this. Solving it should be a high national priority. If the answer is, discussing this would create panic, then democracy is a sham. If the answer is, we don't know what might happen, so we are asserting total control in advance, then this executive order should never have been signed. It transfers too much power to bureaucrats to determine when to implement it. As Dr. North declares, this is no longer a nation run by the Constitution. The executive order itself is long, and very few people will actually bother to read it. But what it does is very clear. It authorizes the White House to take over the entire communications system, simply on the authority of the president. The bottom line is this: Obama thinks that this power belongs to the president. We've seen this coming. We even reported on how a government whistleblower inside the Obama regime blew the lid off of why Barack Hussein Obama has signed all of these executive orders that give him the power to declare martial law across America. According to this whistleblower, Obama, through the Department of Homeland Security, DHS, and other agencies and czars, is plotting a major Reichstag event to generate racial riots and produce the justification for martial law. This DHS whistleblower informed the Canada Free Press that the DHS is actively preparing for massive social unrest inside the United States. He then corrected himself, stating that a civil war is the more appropriate term. Certain elements of the government are not only expecting and preparing for it, they are actually facilitating it. A Reichstag event refers to a fire started in Germany's legislature during Hitler's rise to power. The fire allowed him to grab emergency powers and eliminate his opposition. While he blamed it on communists, historians have long believed that Hitler started the fire himself. According to the anonymous whistleblower inside Obama's DHS, this Reichstag event would take the form of a staged assassination attempt against Barack Obama, carefully choreographed and manufactured by Obama operatives. It would subsequently be blamed on white supremacists and used to enrage the black community to rioting and looting, the DHS source warned. The Obama administration would then use the violence and chaos they created as justification for the imposition of martial law in major urban cities in America, the creation of DHS checkpoints, restriction of travel, and more. The DHS takes their marching orders from the Obama administration, from Obama himself, but mostly from his unappointed czars. And Jared, especially Valerie Jarrett. Don't think for a minute that the administration is doing anything to stabilize events in the United States. They are revolutionaries, and revolutionaries thrive on chaos, he added. This is getting too big to hide. Now, even the media is starting to pick up on the shocking news. Barack Hussein Obama has signed executive orders giving him the power to declare martial law in America. On a recent episode of his Fox News show, Sean Hannity himself declared, "Tonight, we shine the spotlight on an executive order that the White House was hoping that you would never learn about." Now, the president signed the National Defense Resources Preparedness, NDRP, executive order late Friday afternoon. And since that time, now the measure has been virtually ignored by the mainstream media. Now, the order essentially gives the President of the United States absolute power over any and all American resources during both times of peace and national crisis. Now, this includes, but it's not limited to food and livestock, water, plants, energy, health resources, transportation and construction materials, and gives the government the ability to, quote, control the general distribution of any material, including applicable services in the civilian market. Hannity then went on to discuss how this would give the President of the United States the authority to declare basically martial law during times of peace. And to be sure, this is simply the latest string of actions taken by the administration that ignore the basic principles of our Constitution. Barack Obama is out of control. We must stop him now. As you can see, Obama's preparations to institute martial law in America are coming together quickly. First, he signed an executive order for so-called National Defense Resources Preparedness that would give him dictator powers whenever he decides he needs them. Then, he signed another executive order, this time to take control of America's domestic natural gas production. Then, he did it again. He signed yet another executive order, declaring international law for the United States of America. As reported sarcastically by blogger Henry Shively, on May 1, 2012, our glorious leader, Premier Barack Obama, aka Barry Sotor, aka Barry the Rut, signed yet another executive order promoting international regulatory cooperation. This dictate is designed to standardize regulations between the United States and its so-called trading partners. What is a regulation? A law. So what is actually being attempted here is a standardization of international law. It is an absolute violation of the Constitution for the United States to legislate our law outside of our borders. And what exactly can this unconstitutional executive order lead to? As Shively states, considering the many international security agreements the traitors occupying our highest seats of power have entered into, this latest executive order can absolutely be used to institute gun confiscation laws / regulations, without any consent by our Congress or our judicial. And once these foreign laws are brought to the United States under the various security agreements, foreign troops will be brought in to enforce the foreign laws upon the people of the United States. This executive order came hot on the heels of the one that Barack Obama signed to take control of America's domestic natural gas production. As columnist Max Slavo reports, while Americans focused their attention on the Colombian controversy involving the United States Secret Service agents, prostitutes, and excessive drinking, President Obama quietly signed his latest presidential executive order. The Supporting Safe and Responsible Development of Unconventional Domestic Natural Gas Resources executive order seeks to create what amounts to a presidential supercommittee that will oversee the regulation and development of the unconventional natural gas industry for the purpose of ensuring a long-term natural gas supply for the United States, as well as to do so in a safe and environmentally responsible manner. So now, by presidential decree alone, the federal government can coordinate action through 13 core federal agencies against any domestic natural gas production facility, all according to standards determined to be appropriate, not by law, but because of political agenda. Moreover, because a key stated purpose of this executive order is to ensure long-term supplies, Barack Obama's decree gives the federal government the ability to shut down gas production operations as they see fit, which can lead directly to government price fixing and centralized control of an essential natural energy resource. While Obama's executive order aims to curtail some of the practices of the hydraulic fracturing, or fracking, industry, it further expands government control over our lives through more centralization of power and bureaucracy. Things are getting worse. As experts start to dig deeper into Barack Hussein Obama's executive order for so-called national defense resources preparedness, they are reporting just how bad this really is. Obama is preparing to declare martial law in America. As detailed in this report from the Canada Free Press, under this order the heads of these cabinet-level positions, agriculture, energy, health and human services, transportation, defense and commerce can take food, livestock, fertilizer, farm equipment, all forms of energy, water resources, all forms of civil transportation, meaning any vehicles, boats, planes, and any other materials, including construction materials, from wherever they are available. This is probably why the government has been visiting farms with GPS devices, so they know exactly where to go when they turn this one on. Specifically, the government is allowed to allocate materials, services, and facilities as deemed necessary or appropriate. They decide what necessary or appropriate means. This is outrageous. Barack Obama is trying to violate the Constitution, become a dictator, and take away our rights. It's up to you and me to stop him now. We're not alone in reporting this. It's starting to be reported in more and more media sources. For example, this report comes from the Russia Times. As folks headed out to happy hour last Friday evening, President Obama signed an executive order that could potentially give him the power to institute martial law in the United States in times of peace or during a national threat. Many Americans were shocked to find out that this order gives the president practically unlimited power over the United States citizens and their property. All in the name of national security, of course. As we said, Barack Hussein Obama signed a presidential executive order, which would give him the powers of a dictator, whenever he thinks it's necessary, to institute martial law. According to press reports, a White House order updating federal emergency powers has raised alarm among some conservative commentators and the United States Republican Sandy Adams that President Barack Obama is attempting to grab unconstitutional powers. A columnist with the Washington Times declared the mid-March order, an update of a 60-year-old document outlining the president's authority in a national emergency, stunning in its audacity and a flagrant violation of the Constitution. The conservative Drudge Report website linked to it with the headline, "Martial Law." And Adams, R. Orlando, said it leaves the door open for the president to give himself control over American resources during both times of peace and national crisis. It's almost unbelievable what Barack Hussein Obama is trying to do, but it is true. According to a bombshell article in the Washington Times, President Obama has given himself the powers to declare martial law, especially in the event of a war with Iran. It is a sweeping power grab that should worry every American. On March 16, the White House released an executive order, National Defense Resources Preparedness. The document is stunning in its audacity and a flagrant violation of the Constitution. It states that, in case of a war or national emergency, the federal government has the authority to take over almost every aspect of American society. Food, livestock, farming equipment, manufacturing, industry, energy, transportation, hospitals, healthcare facilities, water resources, defense, and construction, all of it could fall under the full control of Mr. Obama. The order empowers the president to dispense these vast resources as he sees fit during a national crisis. In short, according to the Times, the order gives Barack Obama the ability to impose martial law. He now possesses the potential powers of a dictator. The order is a direct assault on individual liberties, private property rights and the rule of law. It is blatantly unconstitutional. The executive branch is arrogating responsibilities precluded by the Constitution without even asking the permission of Congress. The order gives Mr. Obama a blank check to erect a centralized authoritarian state. But why this, and why now? Simple. because he's about to provoke a confrontation with Iran, which could give him the excuse to implement martial law in America, Obama may be ready to launch devastating airstrikes on Iranian nuclear facilities. If that should happen, Iranian President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad has promised massive retaliation. American troops will be targeted by Iranian proxies in Iraq and Afghanistan. American embassies will be struck across the Middle East and North Africa. Most ominously, Iranian-backed Hezbollah cells could launch devastating terrorist attacks in major the United States cities, killing numerous citizens. The war may well come home, triggering domestic chaos. These are the very real risks of a major conflict with Iran. As columnist Jeffrey Kuhner notes, the president does not, and should not, have the authority to subordinate the entire private economy to the government, especially without the consent of Congress and the American people. It is national socialism masquerading as military security. This is why conservatives, those who are serious about defending our constitutional republic, should demand that the executive order be repealed immediately. That's exactly what we need to do, right now. Thankfully, there are members of Congress who are standing up for the United States Constitution. For example, in the last session, Republican Sandy Adams, R. Florida, introduced H. Congress 110 in response to President Obama's blatant attempt to go around the Constitution and institute martial law if he thinks it's necessary. In introducing her bill, Republican Adams stated, President Obama issued a National Defense Resources Preparedness Executive Order on March 16, 2012 that raises some serious concerns in its wording and intent. The order has historically been based on the Defense Production Act of 1950, 50 U.S. C.A.P. 2061 et sec. However, unlike previous presidents, President Obama's executive order broadens the definition of national defense. This leaves the door open for the president to give himself control over American resources during both times of peace and national crisis. In response to the order, I have introduced a resolution to make it clear the president cannot use this as an excuse to abuse his executive power. Republican Adams' bill never got a full vote, because she needed a lot more co-sponsors to get the bill to the floor. So this session, we're going to need a much bigger push to get any anti-martial law bill passed. That's where you and I come in. If we can flood the offices of all of these congressmen, demanding that they immediately pass bills against Obama's grabbing unconstitutional powers through all of his new presidential executive orders, we can put a stop to Obama's attempt to circumvent the Constitution and lay the groundwork for martial law. But we need your help. Send your blast faxes to every single the United States congressman and senator now. Sincerely, William Green, PresidentRightMarch.com. Peace. As Republican Adams stated when introducing her bill last session to stop Barack Obama's attempt to put in place the ability to institute martial law on his own whim, each of us in Congress began our service to our friends, neighbors, and communities with the knowledge it was our responsibility to uphold the Constitution. We were elected to protect the values that make our nation great and to be a line of defense against the growing interjection of government into the everyday lives of the American people. I will continue to defend the principles on which our nation was founded, and I will continue to uphold our Constitution. You and I need to join in and force the rest of Congress to uphold our Constitution. Take action, oh. See links below this video. Audio video transcribed by Truth Soldier. atruthsoldier.wordpress.com